Lord. Unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. For that, let's celebrate for what he came for. He came for you and me. Without him, there's no way that we could be with our Father. So I invite you to worship God, to worship Jesus, for he loves us so much. Glory to you, O God.
Joy to the world. of his righteousness, wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love.
Joy to the world,
joy to the world,
joy to the world,
joy to the world,
joy to the world.
This is the wonderful time of the year that we celebrate God sending his son to be born a man like people on the earth. Isn't this awesome? Don't you love celebrating Jesus' time of coming at his birth? Glory to you, Jesus. We praise you, King Jesus. He's not a baby anymore. Yeah, he grew up, he died for us, and he is with the Father in heaven again. Jesus, we celebrate you in every way that we can today. We give you our hearts, and we give you the glory and honor. Who loves Jesus? Woo! We love you, Lord, with all of our hearts. So this is a time that we
have the opportunity to give and make deposits of money into our heavenly account. Even though the deposit of money is kept here, and we use it to reach out to the poor and needy, and we do other things in the community, we're ultimately worshiping God from our hearts if we're giving this, whatever amount that you give, if we're giving that from our hearts to Jesus. We're worshiping Him from our hearts. It's not that we pay Him money, but we're giving even money the amount that we purpose in our hearts. And then it helps us to be a part of helping this community. That's what Jesus called us to do, is to help the poor and the needy, and to help people that are in prison, and to help feed people and clothe them and do many different things. So we're giving to the Lord. We're depositing into a heavenly account that He is remembering what deposits we've made. And He's going to say, well done, good and faithful servant, someday, even in our hearts, to give money and worship Him in that way. So let's pray. Lord, we come to You. We give You our whole hearts. We give You what we purpose to give from our hearts. And we want to honor You even in the area of giving money toward what You want us to do. So, Lord, we give You the glory in advance. And may many people come to know You because of the generosity of people at City Church. Lord, we praise You and adore You, and we worship You. In Your name, Jesus. Amen.
Think of a better place to be than here on Christmas morning. I don't know about you, but I know we have a number of folks out this morning, people with families and what have you. But I'm glad that you're here, because if you're here, I get to be here. It would be lonely if I were here by myself, right? That just would not work. So I do have a couple of quick announcements. We have our CEO Boot Camp sign up still in the lobby. This is the last Sunday to sign up. And that boot camp will start next month. We'll meet twice during the month on a Saturday, and then the following month twice again. That is being presented by Denise Johnson. She is a consultant for businesses, and has come our way and offered her services to us. So if you're here and you have a thought or a dream of one day starting a business, maybe you're with a company and you'd like to see your career go further within that company, whatever it is, you have an entrepreneurial spirit, a heart that maybe you don't have plans to open a business today, but someday you would like to, I would encourage you to sign up to be a part of those classes, because she will give you all the needed tools that you'll need to be able to go out. And instead of learning the hard way and learning by mistake, she will equip you to be successful. And I just think that's just valuable. The second thing is that if you were baptized the other week and you have not received your baptism certificate, Bruce has it, and he will be in the lobby after service, and he will be giving those out to those of you that have not picked them up as yet. So we're going to turn to two portions of Scripture. I'm going to turn to 1 Luke, and then we're going to turn back to Matthew. And I want to look at the Christmas story, and as our title says, we're going to be pulling from the Christmas story. We're going to be pulling out some gems. Now, some of these gems will be things that you possibly know. Some will be things that maybe you've never heard before, and I'm going to try to dial it in to give us a broader picture of the Christmas story, the birth of Jesus. And we're going to start in Luke chapter 2, and I'm actually going to read Luke chapter 2. I'm going to read verse 1 through verse 20, and then we're going to jump to Matthew chapter 2 also. And the reason that we're doing this is that we're going to look at the birth of Jesus in a chronological order. Because if you are a new Christian and you read these portions of Scripture, you'll ask yourself, why are they telling two different stories and why aren't they on the same page? That's because the writer Luke picks up the birth of Christ from the time that he was born in a manger and the shepherds came. And then in Matthew picks it up at the time when Jesus has left the manger and he is now at home and the Magi come. So we're going to start with Luke chapter 2 and verse 1, and then we're going to jump over to Matthew. And it says, during those days, the Roman Emperor Caesar Augustus ordered that the first census be taken throughout his empire. Cornelius was the governor of Syria at that time, and everyone had to travel to his or her hometown to complete the mandatory census. So Joseph and his fiancée, Mary, left Nazareth, a village in Galilee, and journeyed to their hometown in Judea, to the village of Bethlehem. Now they were ordered to do this. They were ordered to report to the town of their birth for a census. Think of it like the IRS making you go to the place where you were born so that you could report in, they could get your name, they get your number so that you could be taxed. Now, King David's ancient home. And they were required to register there since they were both direct descendants of David. And Mary was pregnant and nearly ready to give birth. Now, I'm just going to stop for a minute. This isn't in my notes, but I just want to stop for a minute because the thought occurred to me early this morning. You see, if you remember prior to them going to the census, when the angel appeared to Mary and said that you are highly favored of the Lord and you're going to give birth to the Messiah, who will be called the Son of God. You're going to give birth to the Messiah who's going to free his people and bring a rulership to the kingdom of heaven on earth. And Mary said, basically, she said, how's that going to happen? How is that going to happen since I'm not married and I'm not with a man? Now, Mary was betrothed to Joseph. They were not married, but they were betrothed to be married. And the angel said to Mary, don't be afraid because the Holy Ghost will come on you and you will become pregnant. And then the angel went on to say that Elizabeth, your relative, is going to give birth in her older age. So two miracles are happening simultaneously. Elizabeth and her husband are beyond the age of childbirth, and Mary now is a virgin. And the angel is telling her, your cousin Elizabeth is pregnant now with child. Actually, she was 6 months pregnant. And then he says to Mary, you are going to become impregnated by the Holy Spirit. And he uses these words. He says basically to her, don't be amazed because all things are possible with God. Now, from there, Joseph finds out about the pregnancy, and Joseph decides he's going to put her away privately so as not to shame her. Now, they're not married, but under Jewish law at that time, when you were engaged, it had the same legal aspect of being married. So technically, Joseph could have had her stoned to death for violating their covenant. But he chooses not to because she is so young, and he feels that if he leaves her with her father's home, she might have a chance at a life. Because if you're older and you were caught in adultery and your husband disowned you, if you didn't get stoned, you were very lucky. And if you didn't get stoned and you went out, you actually went out and had to make your living as a prostitute because going home to your family was not an option. So he is having mercy on Mary. He's trying to protect her, even though in his mind she has slept with somebody and is now impregnated by that man and has violated him. But because of his nature being the kind man that he is, he's having mercy on her. Now an angel comes to him and says, Joseph, don't worry, she's not slept with anybody. Cool your jets. What's happened is by way of the Holy Spirit, I want you to go marry her and marry her. Now, are you with me so far? Watch what's happening. They are now traveling for the census, and she's pregnant, ready to give birth. She gives birth while they're there for the census. Now, it's not in the text, but let's read between the lines for a minute. Society does not know that this is an impregnation by the Holy Spirit. What the public knows is that this woman has become pregnant, and it's not Joseph's baby. They're not married. In fact, they weren't even together. It's not his baby. Can you see how society is looking at her? And looking at him for putting up with it. Then when the baby Jesus is born, how is society looking at baby Jesus? See, this is never talked about. But how's society looking at him? They're looking at him. You're not the son of God. You're a bastard child. You're not the son of God. You're a child born out of an illegitimate relationship that Joseph allowed to happen, and Joseph allowed the marriage to go through for the protection of Mary, but she should have never slept with that guy, and you're his child, whoever that guy is. Okay, now, we're coming back into our story. Mary was pregnant and nearly ready to give birth. And when they arrived in Bethlehem, Mary went into labor, and there she gave birth to her firstborn son. And after wrapping the newborn baby in strips of cloth, or swaddling cloth, after wrapping him in the strips of cloth, they laid him in the feeding trough, since there was no available space in the upper room of the village. Now, houses at that time were built, many of the homes were built where you lived in the second and third floor and or in the summer on the roof. And the cattle were kept down what we would now call the garage. The cattle were kept there. So there was no room up in the upper part of the house, so they offered her the ability, her and Joseph, to stay in the stable part of the home or the garage. Okay, now what's happening here is the writer is now calling out detail. Now remember, I harp on this. Whenever the writer tells us specifics, as in the color, the name, the temperature, the place, whenever specifics are called out, there's a reason for it. He's drawing our attention to something, and he's making it a point. Both right here, he's making it a point. He's saying that the baby was wrapped in strips of cloth and placed in the feeding trough of the manger. Now, why is he telling us that? He's telling us that because it's actually prophetic of what Jesus is to be. He's telling us that because in the Old Testament, the Passover, when they offered the Passover lamb, it was to be without spot or blemish, right? Couldn't be have a spot, it couldn't have a blemish. So when they were traveling to Passover in Jerusalem, and they would leave their homeland, they leave where they were living, and they would travel to where the Passover was to be held, they couldn't take cattle with them. They couldn't take the Passover lamb with them. So what shepherds would do is they would graze sheep around the temple. They would graze sheep close by around the temple. And when sheep were born that were without spot, they would take those sheep and protect the sheep, because when the families descended Jerusalem during the Passover, they would have to go out and buy these Passover lambs. They'd have to go buy them in order to sacrifice them because they didn't bring them. The shepherds would take the lambs without spot, and they would wrap them in swaddling clothes, strips of cloth, and place them in troughs at night so they could not wander off and bruise themselves in the thickets around them. They would protect them because they were to be sold for an offering, for the Passover offering. It's amazing detail how God is showing us that Jesus is to be the sacrificial lamb even in his birth. God is showing us that Jesus, from the time of his birth, was destined to be that sacrificial lamb that they celebrated over Passover. He too was wrapped in swaddling cloth and placed in the trough in the manger. So the story goes on, and it says, that night in the field near Bethlehem, there were shepherds watching over their flocks. And suddenly an angel of the Lord appeared in radiant splendor before them, lighting up the field with blazing glory of God. And the shepherds were terrified. It's interesting that in most occurrences in the Bible, when men have an encounter with heaven and they can visibly see heaven, they usually become terrified. But the angel reassured them, saying, "Don't be afraid, for I have come to bring you good news, the most joyous news the world has ever heard. And it is for everyone, everywhere." We can go into a whole nother rabbit trail, but the angel is telling them at the very birth of Christ, it isn't just for the Jewish nation. It isn't just for Israel. It is for the entire world, everywhere and everyone. It is for the entire world. "For today in Bethlehem, the rescuer was born for you. He is Lord Yeshua, the Messiah, and you will recognize him by this miracle sign. You will find a baby wrapped in strips of cloth lying in the feeding trough." Then all at once, a vast number of glorious angels appeared, the very armies of heaven, and they all praised God, singing, "Glory to God in the highest realms of heaven, for there is peace and good hope given to the sons of men." Now, I can only imagine in the dead of night when everything is dark and the heavens open and you see these angels singing, a choir, the host of heaven singing. I can only imagine what they were feeling. Both fear, awe, and wonder. And when the choir of angels disappeared back to heaven, the shepherds said one another, "Let's go. Let's hurry and find this word that is born in Bethlehem and see for ourselves what the Lord has revealed to us." So they ran into the village and they found their way to Mary and Joseph. And there was the baby lying in the feeding trough. See, the writer keeps telling us that he's lying in the feeding trough. This is the third time. Because he's saying to us that, make no mistakes, this is the Passover lamb in human form. And upon seeing this miraculous sign, the shepherds recounted what had just happened. And everyone who heard the shepherd's story was astonished by what they were told. But Mary treasured all these things in her heart, and often pondered what they meant. And in verse 20, the shepherds returned to their flock ecstatic over what had happened. They praised God and glorified Him for all that they had heard and seen for themselves, just like the angel had said. Now, taking it in chronological order, we're going to go to Matthew chapter 2. And this is the story again, but it picks up later in Jesus' life. Jesus is no longer in the manger. He's no longer in the trough. Jesus has now gone home, and it's estimated that he's somewhere between 1 and 2 years of age. And the story picks up at verse 1. Jesus was born in Bethlehem near Jerusalem during the reign of King Herod. And after Jesus' birth, a group of spiritual priests from east came to Jerusalem and inquired of the people, "Where is the child who is born King of the Jewish people? We observe his star rising in the sky, and we've come to bow before him in worship." It's interesting that the Bible says his star, not just a star. They were looking for a specific star to appear, knowing it was the star of the Messiah. And they call it his star. His star. We saw his star, and we knew he was born. And we've traveled now to find him, the star directing our travel, the star above where he is to be. We've come to that place now, his star. But King Herod was shaken to the core when he heard this. Why? What did he hear? That the king of the Jews, is being born. That would disrupt his kingdom. That's a direct threat to him and his power. And not only him, but all Jerusalem was disturbed when they heard this news. It literally shook the city. This was not a quiet little thing happening off to the side. This was shaking the entire town. So he called a meeting of the Jewish ruling priests and religious scholars, demanding that they tell him where the promised Messiah was prophesied to be born. "He will be born in Bethlehem in the land of Judah," they told him, "because the prophecy states, 'And you, little Bethlehem, are not insignificant among the clans of Judah, for out of you will emerge the shepherd king of my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly summoned a spiritual priest from the east to ascertain the exact time the star first appeared. And he told them, "Now go to Bethlehem and carefully look there for the child. And when you found him, report to me so that I can go bow down and worship him too." Well, that was a lie. So they left, and on their way to Bethlehem, suddenly the same star that they had seen in the east reappeared. And amazed, they watched as it went ahead of them and stopped directly over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they were so ecstatic that they shouted and celebrated with unrestrained joy. And when they came into the house and saw the young child with Mary, his mother, they were overcome, falling to the ground at his feet. They worshiped him. Then they opened their treasure boxes full of gifts and presented him with gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And afterward, they returned to their own country by another route, because God had warned them in a dream not to go back to Herod, to King Herod. There are so many interesting things happening within this birth time that we as a society, we as a culture, we miss it. We just go right over almost all of it. I have nativity scenes that we take out at Christmas and we put on the counter sometimes, and they show shepherds with the magi in a barn with Jesus in a pile of hay, and they miss it. You see, the shepherds first appeared at Jesus when Jesus was first born. The magi come a year to 2 years later. And here's where the Magi, it's believed, come from. Now, the Magi, the Greek word for Magi is the word magos, known as a spiritual advisor. And let me, I'm just going to tell you what I believe, because there are different takes on this depending on where you read and the theologian behind the writing. But I'm going to tell you what I believe, because I believe it somehow orchestrates within the thread of what God had weaved through history. Magi comes from, it's believed that Magi comes from Persia, and they were appointed by Darius, the king of Persia at that time, to be priest over the state's religion. That is Magi. They also served as personal advisors to the king. In fact, many believe that the order of priests, Magi, had been started by Daniel the prophet, who, if you remember, was captured and was in Persia serving this king. And it's believed that Daniel had served as the second in command under King Darius, and he was called, you'll actually find it in the Bible, he was called chief of the Magi. Now, it's known that Daniel was a prophet. We have the book of Daniel. If you read the book of Daniel, there's no doubt that he is a prophet. He prophesied over that region. He prophesied over that time. He prophesied over that kingdom. He is a prophet. Many believe that he was also an astrologer, and he understood the stars and times. Daniel prophesied about the coming of the Messiah. And I believe that it was Daniel that taught the Magi what star to look prophetically, what star would appear and would be, it would be the representation of the birth of the Messiah, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And I believe that from the time of Daniel, the Magi were looking for that star to appear. And when the star appeared, they got their stuff together, and they began to make travel following the star to where the star would show them where Jesus was. And if you look at the distance, it's 1,444 miles from Persia to Jerusalem and to that area. And some estimate that it could be walked in several months, a year, some at 25 miles per day. Well, that's a lot of walking. Some estimate that a camel could pick up maybe a couple hundred miles in a day if it's at full trot. I have no idea. All I know is it took them a year to 2 years to get there. That's all I know. And by the time they come, they've been traveling from their homeland following the star. And as they follow the star, they finally reach their destination. And when they reach their destination, they're in awe. They're in absolute awe. This is the Messiah. This is King of Kings, Lord of Lords. This is God Himself. Can you imagine the awe of that? I was sitting in my office this morning, and I was listening to the worship team practice. And I said to the Lord, Lord, I'll just tell you. As a pastor, this is going to sound really sacrilegious. As a pastor, Christmas just wears me out. It's one thing to be a family man and do Christmas. It's another thing to be a pastor with no family and do Christmas. It's something else to do Christmas being a pastor and a family. It just wears you out. And so this last week has been a busy week with toys coming in and more toys coming in and more. And we have more toys being delivered right now, by the way. Several more bags of toys. See, that's the advantage I have of having an iPad. I can tell what's happening while I'm talking to you. Thank you. Can I type thank you? Wait a minute. No. Anyway, so I'm sitting there going, man, am I beat, Lord. And I'm in my office, and I'm listening to them practice. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit, I had this encounter in my office that was, oh, you today are celebrating the birth of Christ. You today are going to worship like the Magi did. You today are going to worship like the shepherds did. You have the honor of doing that, worshiping God Almighty. And I'm telling you, I had to just throw my hands in the air and begin to worship. And I said to myself, there is no greater opportunity than what I'm experiencing right now. See, I don't know if you caught that by our gathering. We gather today, most of you, you could be home with family, you could be cooking, you could be doing all that, but you chose to be here. Why did you choose to be here? For once, we don't have a great Christmas program today. We came to worship Jesus. That is the program. That is, I was telling Deborah yesterday, I said, you know, a lot of my friends in ministry, they're doing some really awesome stuff. We have one church, a good friend of mine, they took their parking lot and they brought in snow. Right here in Northern California, they brought in truckloads of snow so that the kids go out and play in the snow and ride down snow hills. And I started looking at all the things that people do, and I said, what happened to worshiping Jesus? I don't mean that critical. I'm not criticizing them. If you want to go jump in the snow, go for it. But at some point, we take the emphasis off where the emphasis should be and put it on the wrong thing. This whole world knows nothing about God, but us who gather together and call ourselves Christians in church. And if at one time a year we could stop everything and worship Him, we should worship Him all the time, but at one time a year celebrate the birth of Christ. I'm sorry, I don't want to cheapen that and I don't want to dummy that down. I don't think if I were playing in the snow that the angels in the choir of heaven would be singing. Just saying. So now, the writer tells us that these magi bring gifts. They bring three different gifts. Now they don't mean much to us in our culture, but I have to say that the gifts that they brought were the most valuable gifts of their time. There were no gifts more valuable than that. You see, what do you bring the King of Kings? What do you bring God Almighty? What do you bring Him as a gift? You see, in their culture and even in our culture, the greater the person, the more expensive the gift better be. Right? I mean, if you're a person of status, you're nobility, and you invite me to your place for Christmas, and you're of nobility, well, I'm not going to give you something really cheap. I'm not going to give you a $25 gift card to Starbucks. You get what I'm saying? Because of your status, your status alone demands quality and expense. So what do they bring? They bring the most expensive things they have. And there were more than three of them. Our Christmas story shows three, but there are more than three. Nobody knows how many. There could have been 50 magi. There could have been 100 magi. There could have been 30 magi. But I tell you, there were more than three. And what they brought with them took a caravan to transport. In fact, many believe that they brought military with them to protect them on their journey so they would not be robbed by thieves as they travel. So what they're descending here, and remember the text said that the whole city's in an uproar. Why? Because you've got this army of people coming into town. And as magi, they're dressed themselves in royalty with royal garments and camels decorated in gold and all kinds of jewels. These are not guys that are living out in the farm someplace. They're magi. They're the most respected in Persia. And here they come. And when they come to say, I've come to worship the king, people are going, well, wait a minute, we should be worshiping you. But they're coming to say, no, we're coming to worship the King of Kings. And we brought gifts. Now, I don't know how much they gave Jesus, but it's believed that shortly after, when God told him to flee to Egypt, because Herod was going to kill all the children 2 years and younger, and Joseph left that night with Jesus and fled to Egypt, that they lived for years based on what the Magi gave them. So why did they give gold? Let's just look at each of these real quick. Why did they give gold? Gold, even today, but much more then, gold was the symbol of wealth, power, and divinity. The tabernacle was covered in gold. Many of the items that were used in the tabernacle to serve were solid gold or gold covered. The temple that Solomon built was covered with gold. They had walls that were plated with gold, doors that were plated with gold. There was gold throughout that temple. In fact, the priest's robes, when you read the Old Testament, and Moses was instructed in how to make the priest's robes, their robes were interwoven with gold thread. Gold was everybody, everywhere. It was a symbol of divinity and power and authority. So what do they bring Jesus? They bring Jesus gold. They're saying to Jesus, you are the King of Kings. They're saying to Jesus, you are divine, like the temple and the tabernacle. And they say to Jesus, you are our great priest, like the priest had gold woven in their garment. They're saying, that's who you are, and that's who we worship. We bring you gold. The next thing they brought was frankincense and myrrh. Really interesting. Frankincense and myrrh both are resins that come from trees. And the trees basically can only be found in the top mountains of between Kenya and the Middle East, high along that mountain range. I've seen pictures of them. Amazing. In fact, they grow so high and they're such a scrawny tree that they actually grow and survive where there is absolutely no water. In fact, they've actually been known to grow in rock, in a rock. The trees that produce frankincense and myrrh are almost indestructible. What makes it so valuable is that when it comes to frankincense, frankincense is a part of approximately 17 different trees. And frankincense runs, depending on the tree, either white or it is brown or it is black. And what it is, it's a resin from the tree. White is the most valuable, but it's the rarest and hardest to find. When you buy frankincense today, frankincense oil, it is usually from the brown or black species. It is never from the white, because you couldn't afford it if it was. And what they would do is, these harvesters, when they would go to harvest frankincense, what they would do is they would cut the tree. And they had to be careful not to make too many cuts, because each cut took about 5 years to heal. So they would cut the tree in specific areas, and then the next harvest time they would cut the tree in another area, and they would try not to overcut the tree. But here's what happens. When they cut the tree would bleed a resin. And a resin would seep out and run down the trunk of the tree. And they would wait for the resin then to harden. And when the resin hardened, they would scrape it off the trunk of the tree. And from that, they would make frankincense that was made then into either perfume or incense. It was frankincense that was actually used within the worship, within both the tabernacle and the temple, as an incense to God. I have frankincense. It's not the purest, but I'm telling you, it is the best smell I've ever smelled in my life. Frankincense. It's so costly because it's so hard to harvest, and it's so little that you get, especially if you're after the white frankincense, which is the purest. Why did they give the Messiah frankincense? Because it speaks of his purity. White frankincense, it is pure. It speaks of aroma. He became a sweet aroma to God and to us. It's used in worship as an incense. He became worship to us. We have access to the throne of grace. We have access to God Almighty. We have access to worship because of him. He is that incense that burns for you and I, frankincense. It also spoke of his death, because they used frankincense in burial, because when the body started to decompose, it was believed that the smell was so strong it could overpower the stench of a decomposed body. Frankincense. Myrrh was harvested just like frankincense. Different tree, but harvested the same way. They would cut the tree, and the tree would bleed out. And the resin would dry, and they would scrape it off, and they would make myrrh. Myrrh was used as a incense. Some used it as a perfume. I have myrrh. It smells just as good. Different smell, but just as good. But it was also used as a medicine. It was a medicine to heal and to take away pain. Think of Valiums today. They used myrrh. The tree was cut to bleed. That's why the Bible says in Isaiah, the Bible says that by his stripes we were healed. Just like that tree was cut, and it was as the tree bled, it bled a healing compound, a healing resin that is myrrh. By his stripes, he bled, giving us myrrh that becomes that healing compound to our body by his stripes. He's also called, Jesus is also called the tree of life, because both frankincense and myrrh were life-giving, and he is called the tree of life. It's interesting that when Jesus was on the cross, and he was in excruciating pain, they had first filled a sponge with vinegar and gave it to him to drink. Some believe it was wine, gave it to him to drink, and he drank it. The second time they went up, it said that they dipped it, but they dipped it in myrrh as well, and Jesus refused it. Why did he refuse it? Because he didn't want to become numb to the pain of carrying your sins, my sins, to the cross. He wanted to feel every ounce of excruciating pain. He didn't want to be numbed. So the Magi give him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Let me leave you with this. When did they harvest frankincense and myrrh? was harvested two times a year. One, it was harvested during the Passover months, between March 27th and April the 4th. If you know anything about the feast in the Old Testament, you'll know that Passover celebrates the lamb, redemption, the fact that we have been forgiven because of the Passover, because of the lamb's blood on the post. That's when they harvested frankincense and myrrh. The second time of the year that it was harvested was at the festival tabernacles, which celebrates the king, the kingdom, and kingly rule, which took place somewhere between late September and early October. Those two feasts are two aspects of the Messiah. Frankincense has the pleasant smell, while myrrh provided healing. Jesus is the Passover. He's the Lamb, the sacrifice, and the Redeemer. Jesus is also the Festival of Tabernacles. He's the Lion. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's Lord, our Deliverer, and He's Lord coming again. He is Lord God Almighty. That is the birth of Jesus. And the writer wants us to know all the different aspects of His birth. That's why we're being told about it in both Luke and Matthew. The worship team is going to come now, and we're going to get ready to take communion. There are, nobody can seem to agree on the exact number, but it's commonly agreed that there are 300, some say upwards to 540 prophecies about the Messiah in the Old Testament. 300 prophecies telling of the Messiah coming in our Old Testament. Those prophecies were written in different parts of the world, different nations, over different time periods. They weren't written at the same time in one place. Different parts of the world, written in different time periods. One written at 500 years, another one written 500 years later. Written by different writers, written in different languages. Mathematicians will tell you that mathematically, it is impossible for one man to fulfill all of those prophetic words, 300. It is mathematically impossible for that to be fulfilled in one man. Why did God do that? Why did God do that? God wanted to deliver a message that beyond a shadow of a doubt, beyond any reason of doubt, Jesus Christ is the Son of God. God Almighty, Lord of Lords, King of Kings. And today we celebrate the birth of Jesus. That's why we're here. He's not some cute little baby stuck in a feeding trough. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I can't think of a better way to acknowledge that than to take communion. Our ushers are going to pass out the elements, and as you take it, hold it, and then we're going to take together when they're done.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth.
Hallelujah.
Long lay the
forgive sin and bring us into right fellowship with God the Father. We thank you for that. In your name, amen. Just like the tree that gave myrrh and frankincense was cut, the Bible says, by his stripes we are healed. He was cut. And just like the tree bled a resin, he was cut, but he bled blood. And when the pain was so great that they offered him myrrh to quiet the pain, he refused it. Refused it to feel the full extent of our sin and the penalty for it. Jesus, thank you for the blood that you shed for us. We praise you, we honor you, we give you thanks this morning that you so willingly shed your blood for us, that we could be cleansed, that we could be healed. We thank you for that in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
The worship team is going to close us out in a song. And we have a great lunch for you today if you can stay. All of these toys, by the way, came in after Christmas. Any of the kids that are here today in the kids zone, they're going to be able to come in and take whatever they want. If you're going to be with family today and there are some kids in the family that you, where you're visiting, I invite you to come take whatever you want. This is God's abundance. This comes from the CHP. So, and I believe more have come in, so we'll be putting those out as well. So, amen. God bless you guys.
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child.
To love one another, oh God. So let us be true to your command to love and to serve each other. In Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
There's always someone who has it worse than you. Sometimes you gotta pay your dues. So don't worry, just push on through.
Even in the